sort of start the ball rolling. Phineas, you really concentrated on the human event and the need to take part in human events, losing your inhibitions, and that then becomes the sort of the real life trigger for the exhibition. But you said actually very little about the shows that you have actually done. Do you have a view on actually how you show the buildings, the drawings, the models, the buildings, the things?
Do I have a view?
Or have you had views? I mean, after all, that's what I thought you were doing a lot of the time. It's great to see those things.
I feel like there should be more fun in the way that we go about showing, talking about architecture, architects, architectural issues. And I think that possibly what the AF of the past didn't do enough was have any fun. Now that doesn't necessarily mean carnivalesque silliness like we've had at Turncoats, but it does mean something more memorable and maybe less earnest than we usually get from the industry. And I think this is sort of starting to creep into the culture, because we talk about inclusivity as like we need to reach out to this bigger audience, but we tend not to think, and could the way that we do that make to be the making the events that we put together the kind of events that people want to go to, they don't feel obliged to go to, or that they should go because they need to sort of build up their CV or tick some boxes. I think that was the success of Turncoats and why it spread around the world, was people dragged their friends along because they absolutely loved it. And it's hard to think of many examples of that, at least in the kind of London architecture bubble, where people go, you know, this was great. Like, I don't care whether you're like a total expert on Adolf Loos or have never heard of Adolf Loos, you will get something out of this discussion about Loos and ornament, and that you'll remember. Maybe that's not quite what you're getting at.
Well, supposing somebody comes along and they've not seen Adolf Loos or whatever the reference is,
yeah,
then you might need to show them some pictures and models and drawings and all the rest of it. That's presumably the idea of an exhibition, is that it's an illustrated event. Yeah.
Well, I think, I don't know, I was going to say this for later on down the track, but maybe I say it now, which is, I think there's a difference between architectural exhibitions and exhibitions of architecture, or exhibitions about architecture, because for me, the big difference, and we often confuse the two, but you've got you know, a lot of the kind of Wirkbund and other forms of exhibition that you were describing, they are really kind of prototypes for space or prototypes for ways of dealing with materials. They're not scaled. We sometimes call them full scale, but they're not full scale. The space is, as you said, you know, you either have something which is represented, so it's a model because the building can't be there, or the space is itself. I mean, it's not representing anything. It just is the thing. And I think then, you know, there are two kind of separate questions. One, which really sits within, for me, the history of art and how you display objects and where the object refers, what it refers to, and kind of modes of media and presentation. The other, which is, I think, more what Finn is doing, which is what I would consider to be an architectural exhibition rather than an exhibition about architecture, because you're trying to take, you know, what for me is the essence of architecture? Well, the essence of architecture is a spatial proposition, and it's taking things which are often not spatial and finding a way to give them form in space, and as, you know, Cedric Price would say, in time as well. And so it's, I think it's really interesting when you take something like a panel event and you consider it in an architectural way, and you effectively conduct a kind of design on an event. And that's really, for me, what the Architecture Foundation has done.
Well, convening is a spatial event, isn't it? We're all sitting at a certain distance, and this is something I've lectured about myself, that the first architecture is a space that's established between two or three people. Mm. The horizontal domain, and the building stuff, the Baustoff, only comes in later. Nevertheless, there is a reference here. It's called, you know, that stuff. And although you're trying to open up and embrace and include and invite, if it works, then there will be people who come without so much visual knowledge. And that's to me, it's like the illustration and the discourse, the talk and the pictures.
I think what Dean's saying to us is radically different than the way that we might approach a biennial or an art gallery. He's saying something that's radically kind of different. It's about people getting involved, it's about events, and it's about kind of activities. That's what he's describing, and it's very kind of different from imagining, you know,
yes, but what I'm going to grind an axe here. What I'm driving at here is that it does seem to me, if I may make a bit of a criticism of your events, I suspect that most of them were converts already. They're already architects, and therefore they know what you're talking about when you have these discussions.
I've actually been surprised that that's not the case. I sort of assumed it would be, but you talk to people in the audience and. Doesn't seem to be the case. The people who come to see Nishi's artwork are their architects. The people who come to the projects I've shown, not so much.
But it must be a challenge to Suzy and how to arrange that new gallery down there with that kind of view in mind. I can only see a challenge there. And the other thing is that, you know, this first exhibition was all old projects of Liverpool. And I'm sure the public will be asking why it never happened. Brian's telling us about the Overhead Railway. Why was it taken down? They are political kind of decisions. So will the public ask and get answers? Why was the cloud never actually realised? The public will ask those things. And I think they're quite serious questions that they're asking.
I think, firstly, I find what the Architectural Foundation is doing incredibly exciting. Not challenging in any way whatsoever. I think they're much more aligned with contemporary thinking around exhibition making and the use of gallery spaces. So my background is in working in galleries, and I don't see them as these sort of quiet temples of contemplation. I think actually galleries, because the buildings are useful in themselves, should be thought of in a very, very different way. So whether that's about displaying contemporary visual art, or about showing architecture, I think we really need to rethink what the gallery is. Often, I think you guys have probably found this. Gallery is like a huge ball and chain because you have to continuously fill it. It's an enormous financial drain you have to continuously pay for. And installing things in it, using it, is enormously expensive. It's not terribly sustainable. So I think. And I mentioned to Brian before I came to do this that I was slightly reluctant to talk about our programme because these are conversations that we're having internally. And that I would quite like to see an enormous shake-up of our programming and completely rethinking what the way in which we're using our spaces. So at the moment I'm going through this terribly laborious process of defining what the products are in our Aberdeen office. Project management terminology, and I've purposefully not called them gallery spaces in that process. I've called them flexible spaces so that we can use them in any way we choose. As soon as you say you have a gallery space, there's a certain assumption about the way in which it can be used, and I don't really want that for our opinion.
Well,
the first exhibition is, you're right, the first exhibition is very traditional. And I think that's important, there's a place for that, but that's for a particular audience. And for me, the way in which I program it's audience first. The audience that we're targeting that first exhibition at is probably not the audience that you guys get for some of your events. When we're targeting at a different audience, we may choose to do some programming which is maybe more subversive. But people will also, to answer, so there's two parts of that, people will ask those questions. And I wanted the first exhibition to be quite celebratory. So, as I mentioned, the first exhibition has been in planning for a long time, and I think you said in your introductory speech that it was about Unbuilt Liverpool. And originally it was about Unbuilt Liverpool, and I was brought in to manage that project halfway through it when it had already been curated. And I was quite concerned that it was this kind of what was that TV show, Bullseye, where they brought out a caravan at the end and they went, oh, look what you could have won, you know. I was really concerned about that we were going to launch this centre with this exhibition of, well, look at all these amazing buildings you could have had, but you didn't get any of them. So hence why we commissioned this film, that then we're not really looking at those buildings in this exhibition. It's a platform to start that conversation around, you know, Liverpool Waters is potentially an amazing opportunity to develop the city. Potentially we could do some extraordinary things. So what is it about these, sorry, I'm assuming my presentation is behind there, that's wrong. You know, about those buildings that these audacious proposals, what is it about those ideas? What is it about the process those architects went through? That made them extraordinary, and how might we re-embrace that in terms of planning, in terms of the public embracing, pushing for extraordinary spaces, that's important, and how might that influence the development of the city, rather than looking at the individual buildings and go, why wasn't that built? Why didn't we get the cloud? So hopefully that's what it is, and I think I'm rambling a little bit here and going on for a long time, but I think it's similar to what is happening with the Architectural Foundation. They're just platforms for debate and discussion. They're just happening in a very, very different way.
What one of the things that triggered my interest in this is an experience that I had, or I heard of, really, that occurred here in the school about 20 years ago, when Doug Cleland was the head. I believe it's true to say that at that time, he got students to convene focus groups. Focus groups, of course, became a notorious now means of political program planning. The idea was that you find out what the market wants, and then you kind of do what you find out from the focus group. And the idea was that students would get a group of the public, which were in this case mostly the employees of the university, people like the cleaners and the assistants and so on, and give them pictures of the best housing of the recent decades. It was mostly, of course, from Germany, Holland, Switzerland, Scandinavia, all the usual suspects. And see if there was a way that you could find out how to direct housing design policy. One of the things that occurred was that they didn't make much progress for the simple reason that many of these people, it was a problem of credibility. It wasn't that they didn't like what they were being shown. They just didn't believe it. They'd never seen anything remotely like this, of that quality. They couldn't believe that such things could be public housing. They were that ignorant. And that's why I'm trying to say that you can't have discussions until people have been informed. Reith's motto, I think, for the BBC when he found it, educate, inform, entertain. And
right, so I guess, like, Martin Evans, who's a developer, housing developer, would say, don't tell me you're funny, tell me a joke. And I think that hits at something quite profound, which is if you sense there is a thing that needs addressing or more discourse, there are many ways to kind of push the public in that direction. So if, for example, you think that there should be more architectural collectives, you could write about that or do an exhibition about that. Or you could be assembled and start one and prove it. If you think that workspaces are too siloed and you should have a kind of workspace that is blends with nightlife culture, you could write about it, or you could do an exhibition, or you could be second home and start it. If you think that there's problems with architectural discourse and it's not expansive enough, you could write about it or do an exhibition, or you could be Jack and start the real review. So I think that if there is a shift taking place in what kind of independent institutions like the AF could or should be thinking about, it's challenging the kind of assumption that our primary operation is through the kind of traditional means of exhibition, books, articles. Yeah, those things are all great, right? We have done some extremely effective exhibitions in our time. We did a massive one in Croydon a decade ago. It's been hugely influential. But it's not always the right solution. And I just desperately want a bit more creativity from my kind of peers in London, thinking through, like, what are we trying to achieve here? And what is the roadmap that we're going to implement to get there without sort of jumping to the conclusion that what is required is an exhibition that takes 3 years planning, or what is required is a symposium with academics from around Europe. I think that those are kind of,
so I think
they're fine, but we could try other things.
A number of strategic differences opening up here, which please join in now.
I've just got something to add. I think it's been asked before, what are these events, who are these events for? And there's various audiences, and we're all different. Everyone's got a different opinion of what they want to see when they go and see these type of events. So I think it's good that there's so many variations of what we can do. It doesn't have to be an exhibition, it can be an event. I think having those type of events, those different type of events we can do, means that you're meeting different audiences, I think. And the fact that you're saying it needs to be challenging, I think that's a good thing.
I would agree. I mean, I think there's something really interesting in what. Oh, so, I'm sorry. I can't see anyone. I'm in the front.
That was my fault.
I had a question, but I won't frame it in the way I was going to, because it sounded like a telling. I was brought alive by the good grief and the the Brexit and the business of the Biennale Pavilion, because it seems to me we're in the middle of a project where we want to envision the future. Some architects do that. What that project will look like will never be seen, because you'll never know you're living in Brexit land. You can't see it. You see it in the exchange rate. I'd like to ask the members of the panel what their Brexit pavilion would contain. Particularly, what Reva would do with a Brexit pavilion.
That's probably fairly straightforward for me to answer, because I don't have a programmer.
That sounds like the right sort of content.
Lies and empty hopes.
Just
a live Twitter feed, because
a
dialogue of what
it's going to be virtual. Yeah,
a virtual world.
That helps me in one way, because I'm still drawing it.
Real Foundation had a proposal that was actually about a year before the referendum of Brexit. It was more in response to the Indie Ref in Scotland. But unfortunately, there were all sorts of barriers which made it very difficult to achieve. But the concept was, it was called After Britain. And the idea was that rather than looking at, it was basically a process of re-federalization, of redesign of Britain as a federal geographic unit, which was based on a kind of local entity. And therefore, rather than having each nation by itself, what you would say is, all right, well, Liverpool City is now effectively an autonomous state which sits within the Federal Union. And the idea then was to partner with architecture schools in each of the current national capitals, but also the regional capitals as well, and run design studios where they all have a common brief to design. If Liverpool is now the capital of its own country, you're going to need new infrastructure, new housing, new parliament and civic spaces. How do you approach that? And then basically at the end of it, to group them all together into a traveling exhibition so that you engage both with the local architecture students and at a national level. And you use this, I think, huge kind of untapped creativity which exists in order to start a discussion, which is actually fundamentally a political one, which is how should we organize our country, how do we represent ourselves, how do we make decisions collectively. And in that sense, I think that, you know, for me, the question of whether you use traditional architectural methods of representation is completely about how it is you, what ideas it is you're trying to put forward. And they can be used very effectively for things which are, the design project in that, the design in that project is actually nation building, but the exhibition design in the end will be models, drawings, and so on.
I mean, to some extent, maybe this is turning on the question of what is an architecture museum as opposed to an exhibition. You might say that the purpose of a museum would be to display permanently and always what has been the best examples of practice, so that people can, when they go to debates and take part in arguments, they know what they're talking about. They can see what was, what could be good. Because if you haven't got a model in your head, if you haven't got an image from somewhere, no matter how agitated you are, you won't bring much to the table. Jamie.
I'll pick up on that comment of what you said earlier about ignorance, in the idea that you are in some way critical of an audience which you believe is ill-informed. But the idea in this day and age, after the events of the last year, that audiences and publics are informed and can be informed by some kind of canon of knowledge is clearly unravelling. And I think going back to, you know, to what Jack's saying about the political necessity or the political underpinning of why many architecture exhibitions actually contain some kind of manifesto and some kind of agenda. But the creation of the audience is incredibly difficult in an age of alternate forms of entertainment, alternate forms of media, where, you know, I would think there's a lot of pressure on creating any kind of audience to a physical event whatsoever. And it seems that action is the underlying theme, and that in some ways some of the static qualities that I think you're touching on about a canon of quality are kind of somehow going to struggle in the future, because as we see politically, who holds that canon of how things should be, or which facts are the facts to be established as good housing, for example?
That authority, though, in a way, can also be kind of used as a tool. I think Riva North has a huge, a colossal potential within it, because everyone knows that Riva is effectively the official organ of architecture in the UK. And so if Riva North decides to do an exhibition about, you know, post-Brexit. Sorry?
Perhaps not Michael Gove, as I recall.
Yeah, well, that's a rather different story. I'd be interested to see where his career goes, actually. But yeah, I mean, in a way, you know, using that authority, you can play that game. You can either be, you know, very low, very rapid. You can be very low cost. You can be very, and you know, you can use your authority in a very kind of ambiguous way. But you can also create these kind of, you know, the Royal Academy shows, for example, when they decide that they're going to do a show on you know, Palladio, it's like that's the thing, right?
It's,
and in a way, that's
credibility.
Yeah, and that credibility. But also at the same time, it's always for me a question of the contemporary, and also what constitutes why something is relevant. Because if you take something that's historical, like I think your example, Brian, was a very good one, which is you take something which is historical, like a railway, which doesn't appear to be very relevant initially, and then you explain why that's relevant to today, why that history, in fact, is useful in the current moment, and what it helps us to do. And maybe it's a kind of operative idea of history, but I'm much more interested in grand institutions using that authority in their historical material in order to say, actually, you know, as you said, that this is the history of housing. Look at these awesome examples which have existed in the past, in order to draw attention to the fact that we don't have that today.
I mean, most people, you know, the huddled masses, the only architectural exhibition they'll ever go to is a Persimmon Barrett show house with flags flying all around some building site, you know, and we know what they're like. And that's about the limit of their experience. So I'm excited by architectural exhibitions as a way of really informing public debate.
But if they don't go to, why are they going to attend?
Well, you make them interesting and spectacular and beautiful.
I think there's an argument here for architectural exhibitions, and I think this is kind of happening now, to kind of catch up with art exhibitions. You know, there's the role of the museum and the role of the collection in that kind of authority. But there's new and interesting ways to engage with those things, and that's not to say that one way is better or the other, there's just different ways of doing it. And I think that's dependent on audiences. So there's different audiences, there's particular individuals who want to engage with a particular subject in one way, and that might be through a very traditional exhibition. But then there's other audiences who are demanding different ways of engaging with debate and discussion. And therefore, if an organisation, for example the RIBA, chooses or decides that they want to engage with that particular audience who are not interested in attending traditional exhibitions and they're not getting much out of it, then they need to look at different ways of interrogating those ideas. But on the same tack, if we as an organisation are saying, well, actually, we want to be engaging with those audiences who want to go to exhibitions, who want to go to a very formal talk, then that's how we would present things.
But, I mean, maybe it's a matter of finding out where popularity occurs and building on it. For instance, we know that a lot of people go to National Trust houses for weekends and parks. That's one starting point.
We also know that the National Trust are diversifying their contemporary programming because they're trying to target a completely different audience.
Well,
because eventually they need to change their approach. So we might need to do the same.
But I'm just trying to... Another would be to take certain very successful TV programmes like that. Was it this guy who shows people building their own house?
Kevin MacLeod.
And have an exhibition of what they've had on television. Another would be to have exhibitions of places that are, you know, it's a matter, I think, of combining the exhibition with the other media that are much more diffusedly plugged into various publics.
I mean, it's very easy to run the Architecture Foundation because you know what will sell out, right? If I put Thomas Heatherwick on a 2,000 person stage, it'll sell out and I'll make loads of money out of it. I don't want to do that because Heatherwick's rubbish. So I'm not sort of saying that we should suspend critical judgment when we're creating projects. I'm saying we should be more critical about the means and who we're picking and what we're picking them to be part of. I think there is a sense of, like, who are we kidding? The most important architectural exhibition in the world is not Venice, it's MIPIM, which is a gigantic trade show that happens in Cannes every year, and all the architects and all the local authorities go there, all the developers go there, and they all sell each other pieces of our cities. At the moment, architects go there like sort of flies on a shit trying to get a like tiny piece of nourishment. RBA has a stand there, of course, sort of desperately trying to say,
look at us.
Maybe get a yacht. But like, that is where the real business of architecture takes place, at MIPIM. And all of our triennales and biennales and the London Festival of Architecture are kind of drops in the ocean or kind of moss on the side of the mountain or something. And we need to go up a gear. We're not going to kind of change the world by continuing to do British pavilions, no offence, Jack. We do need to sort of go back to the drawing board a little bit and try and engage with Sadiq Khan, try and engage with the EU. We can't just kind of continuously talk to ourselves.
Can I suggest that if you take Coney Island and Chicago, the White City, for the Burnham project, these were massive incubators out of kind of fairgrounds. It seems to me that by default, sometimes this architecture can develop from just that sort of enterprise, effectively. Instead of trying to get children into a museum to play with blocks around a Le Corbusier model, which I would really question because it doesn't work, I would get the children on a fairground drive. I would say effectively set up theme parks that then get demolished and carry those messages deep into the future, partly because you've got multiple architectural initiatives happening all at once, often kind of scrambled. but it's only within that sort of flower bed, you know?
What I would like to see is the children building those fairground rides, designing and building their own, and then riding in their
own. We've got 5 minutes, I want more vox pop. There's Jamie at the back, please, some more. And Richard then. Jamie first.
Just in relation to that point of fairground, and again, I don't know all the history of the RIB and architecture, but essentially, Liverpool thrives as a city of tourism. And it seems, in terms of the masses that Brian is, you know, keen for us all to engage with, when people choose to go on a city break to Copenhagen or Amsterdam because they like it, you know, maybe a wider circle, you know, wider population choose that. But where people make their choices for tourism, and the role of which tourism plays in continuing culture, and I guess maybe for the RIB North, in a certain regard, its location in Man Island and everything else, and indeed some of these institutions, these campus institutions, they are part of tourism as a broad economic engine to pay for these things. I just wonder if that is a. Is that the means by which you leverage additional exposure?
Yes, partly. So I think there's two similar drivers there. Like I said in my presentation, RIB North is a commercial project. And hopefully within that there's some critical ability. But it's a commercial project. It sits under RIB Commercial. So it is a visitor destination, but I think even looking at that, it can't be financially viable. So for me, when I said at the beginning it needs to be useful and resourceful to our member and public audiences, that public audience is quite a big chunk of that. We presume, we don't know yet because we're not open, so hopefully this time next year I will be able to tell you this with firm data. But we presume will be people visiting the city, people with an existing interest in architecture who are visiting the city. People who are visiting the city because of the World Heritage Site. So the media table, we're in discussion about that becoming the hub of the World Heritage Site. But it's absolutely crucial that it's used by the profession. That it's used on a very kind of basic level, that they visit, they book rooms, they drink tea and coffee and have meetings in our cafe. But the media table and the data that holds is an enormously powerful planning tool, and there's enormous capacity for income generation through that. And it's those things that will hopefully then fund a more innovative approach to our public programme.
Richard?
I just wanted to go back to the point about the Venice Biennale. The Architecture Biennale is it the odd or the even years? I can't remember. But the point is that there's an Art Biennale and then there's an Architecture Biennale the next year. That's the format, isn't it? And I can't remember how many years ago you mentioned this idea to me, Brian, that there's an Art Biennale in Liverpool now every 2 years. It would be a very, very clever idea to have an architecture one in the odd year.
Well, I only have clever ideas.
Now, I don't know why it's a kind of compelling idea, but in a way, it makes a great deal of sense. My problem is I'm not quite sure what identity the Liverpool Art Biennale has developed, but I would have thought that's almost the starting point for thinking about the...
Well, I can say one thing about the Art Biennial. I can say this.
Can I finish, Brian?
Oh,
so that's a question. What kind of identity has Liverpool developed in its Art Biennial? Because most cities now have these kinds of things. If Liverpool were to have an architecture one in the intervening year, then I think it would be in a unique position. I don't think there's any other city in Britain that does that. The point that Jack made about not getting obsessed with kind of organising events and exhibitions and so on and so on and so on is absolutely correct. There has to be some idea of what these things are for. But there's something there is something interestingly kind of niggling about this idea of coupling up an architecture event with the art event.
Well,
okay, can I just make one final point? You mentioned the extraordinary fact of the Le Corbusier exhibition, which was held at the Walker in 1958.
Oh, yeah.
Which had 17,000 visitors, apparently. Now, by modern standards, that's not an enormous number. But actually, if you think of 17,000 Liverpudlians looking at a Le Corbusier exhibition at the Walker in 1958, it's an extraordinary idea, actually. So I think there's, an enormous opportunity for absolutely dead straightforward explanatory, pedagogic, however you can describe it, exhibitions about things which interest people. I don't think it's a problem.
Well, I'll make two points by way of answer. Concerning the art biennial, I don't know if we've got anybody here who's worked with it, but I've worked a little bit with it. Lewis Biggs, who is the first director of it and had previously been director of Tate Liverpool. I spoke to him once because when they had the press conference to open the Liverpool Tate, Alan Bowness was the director of Tate at that time, very good man, but of his generation, did not really go onto site-specific installations in the 50s when he was in his heyday. And at the press conference I said, look, site-specific installation thrives on derelict land. That's where it was pioneered. Liverpool's got to it, lots of it, did certainly have more in the 80s. Therefore, why doesn't the Tate make a speciality of becoming the National Museum of Site-Specific Installation? Alan Bowness didn't really have a strong answer. But Lewis Biggs did. He had this idea that Liverpool was particularly good for that. And that was the first thing I realised about coming to the Liverpool Art Biennial. It took you on a tour of the city, and you went to buildings that you would never otherwise get to. And that's and that was when I first thought about an architecture biennial. The second point I would make, that in one of the manifestos I wrote, I said, look, it's no use thinking small in this. The whole point about a biennial is that it's so big that virtually every idea that has been heard this morning, in this this afternoon, in this room, will be included. We're not talking about a small event. We're talking about an aggregate event of many different kinds of events. And that was, I think, the lesson that came through from your sequence: the variety of things that is done when you can, when you do a big biennial exhibition that takes 2 years. The planning. Dominic, did you have a point?
Was it? Oh, it was really a side really for Suzy. You want to make our IBA, give it to the financial security, turn it into a bar. Architects run the best bars.
We have a bar.
And Phineas can hold one of his parties there.
What I'd do if I was the RIBA is I'd leverage my massive assets and my 250 staff to get a huge loan from a pension fund, and I'd build houses, and I'd build the best houses in the country every year, and that would become a core part of my program. And that would be the way that you change the housing culture, or the housing design guide, or the standards by which developers hold themselves to, is to actually show them the alternative, make it happen, rent it out, and to kind of prove the business model. So
you,
I think there's lots of things that the RBA should do that it doesn't do, and there's stuff that it does do that it shouldn't do. But it's sort of a really obvious one is to build some houses. If you've got the capital, leverage it.
At last, I was feeling a bit detached from this conversation. That's the vital thing, because you build something, and in the building, you then engage, and you build a capacity for people understanding what they're getting. The best model for this was Berlin. I'd worked in Berlin with, and even the higher people, the Hans Simmons, the people who were organising the city, there was an engagement with the public through the IBA, through the big architectural competitions. To me, an architectural biennial in Liverpool should have at its core architectural competitions for real buildings in which there is engagement at every stage. Because architecture, we may not like it, but architecture as a subject is about the projection of power. So the question is, who holds this power? Now, in my mind, and I've talked with people like Rob in the past, with DIY City, the ultimate aim is to put power away from where it is now and into the hands of ordinary people, of working class people. That's a kind of program. Now, if you're building houses and you're engaging with people and you're building capacity, that's a step in that direction. And to me, that's what an architectural biennial with full ambition would be doing.
Perhaps we need a new kind of building society instead of just, you know, a building society that just does houses. It specifically builds show houses, experiment houses, example houses. Could somebody invent such an institution?